Kính thưa quý vị, chúng tôi là luật sư Nguyễn Hoàng Dũng. Ngày hôm nay được hân hạnh nói chuyện với quý vị về đề tài luật EB-5 và những thay đổi trong luật này trong thời gian gần đây. Và đặc biệt là ngày hôm nay chúng tôi có hai vị khách mời là những người đã từng cộng tác mật thiết với USIS trong nhiều năm qua. Trước hết, chúng tôi xin giới thiệu đến quý vị luật sư David Herson, là người điều hành của tổ hợp luật sư Herson and Partners. Good morning, David.
Good morning. Thank you for having me. I am an immigration lawyer in Southern California, and all the work we do is immigration law. David Herson and Partners has effectively been running since 1980 with different firm names. And as far as the EB-5 program is concerned, I filed one of the very first applications in the country and got it approved in 1992 after the new regional center law was brought into effect. I'm a certified specialist in immigration and nationality law and have been so for many, many years. Our firm has multiple languages, particularly for this purpose. We have a Vietnamese attorney and assistants, and we can read, write, and speak Vietnamese to all the clients. We also visit Vietnam on a regular basis, so live meetings can also be held, where we do trainings of different agencies and others in how to do the source of funds. Our work is very inclusive of all EB-5 aspects, whether it's the projects or the regional centers or the individual investors.
Thank you. Và kính thưa quý vị, người kế tiếp là ông Greg Hayden, là người điều hành của tổ chức New York City Regional Center, một trung tâm vùng nổi tiếng. Mr. Hayden.
Thank you for having me. My name is Greg Hayden. I'm general manager of the New York City Regional Center. We were approved in 2008 by USCIS. Since that time, we have achieved 21 project approvals. We've raised about $1.5 billion in EB-5 funds for informal public-private partnerships in and around New York City with governmental agencies on government land. We have over 1,600 IE-29 approvals, over 4,600 permanent green cards issued, and we have repaid 250 families in our first two projects all of the money back, and we have over 5,600 conditional green cards where people and individuals have actually moved to the United States and are now living in the United States waiting for their permanent resident status. Currently, we have a Fresh Direct project, phase two, which is 85% complete and will be fully completed in July, and we have available allocations in that project. And we've met with wonderful success in Vietnam with USIS Group, and we enjoy that wonderful cooperation, largely because they have an excellent document processing staff. Thank you.
Thank you for your time. So let's begin our discussion. I will begin the discussion with Attorney Herson. Could you please tell our audience general ideas about EB-5 program and what are the stages?
Certainly. There are three stages. I'm going to give you a brief summary for the reasons of time. Firstly, the investment must be either $1 million or $500,000, depending on location. This may go up or will go up at some time with the changing law. Secondly, 10 full-time legal workers have to be employed. Thirdly, the money must come from a lawful source, and the employees have to be legal and on payroll for the direct hire program, which is the one from 1990. The second program is the regional center program from 1992, where the employment can be shown indirectly using economic formulae.
Mr. Hayden, Attorney Herson just mentioned the regional center being in existence since 1992. How does that play? How does the regional center play a role in the EB-5 process?
Basically, in a different way, where the direct program is all the responsibility of creating the jobs, reporting the jobs, and falls on the investor. Whereas the regional center program is designed to be a turnkey program, providing all the immigration standards for the federal agency, USCIS, to review, approve, and the regional center delivers on that by helping to or facilitating the job creation and reporting of that job creation for the ultimate permanent green card.
I suppose then going with the regional center would be more advantageous for the investors, is that correct?
it's much less of a burden, and the underwriting falls on the investor for the most part, but they're relying on things like track record, whether the regional center has returned money or not, and whether they have IE29 approvals or what other kind of standards they might review. But they might also review the structure of the project and where their capital sits in the capital stack.
How is it that New York City Regional Center is different than the rest?
We're different in the way that we don't do private development transactions. We do informal public-private partnerships with New York City and New York State government and some of the other agencies in and around New York. All of our projects are on government land, so that allows us to eliminate land cost, which dramatically reduces the risk, because in that way we eliminate the need for a commercial bank. We become the commercial bank, and our investors get first lien security. They get collateral to protect their investment the entire time they're with us.
Thank you. Attorney Hurson, what should be the things that the investors should be looking for in doing EB-5?
Well, the basic due diligence needs to be done, and that's to follow what Greg has spoken about in terms of quality of the investment, history, reliability, and so on. Then you've got to look at where you're going to make your investment from a standpoint of is it a good area? Is it a $500,000 area, which is called a targeted employment area, or is it in the higher level area? These are things that you watch out for right up front. The other thing you need to do is be sure that your source of funds is very accurate and properly documented.
I understand that you have been doing this for 38 years. You are an immigrant yourself, correct?
Yes, I am an immigrant myself, and I filed the first EB-5 case in 1992, after the late 1991 Regional Center Program came into effect.
So over the years, what have you seen as the challenges that the investors face in this process, and what can they do to help themselves in these processes?
That's a good question. It's very broad. I'll try and keep the answer short. Firstly, there is Congress and the perception of Congress about the program. They see the two or three bad deals and the hundreds of good ones they don't bring to attention. Then there's the uncertainty that Congress brings to the system, because they can't make it into the regional center part into a permanent program, which should have been done many, many years ago. Then the proof of lawful source of funds has become a much more challenging exercise than it was 20 years ago, where you just basically gave some brief information about the money and the case was approved. Today, it is a very detailed, fully documented report that has to be submitted to USCIS.
Mr. Hayden,
yes.
There are many projects, many regional centers out there with many different projects. Mm-hmm. Currently, does New York City Regional Center have any projects that can be offered to the investors?
Yes, we do. And again, you know, we have a long history. All of our projects have an I-924, which is an approved project by the agency in Washington, USCIS. It's also I-526 approved, which means as investors are approved inside of that project. It's a phase two called Fresh Direct Phase Two, and it's a food manufacturing and distribution facility that was built in the South Bronx, just half a mile from New York City, and it services about 80,000 customers. It's open, it's operational, it'll be 100% complete in July, and I think at this moment in time, the amount of money that has been spent, we are now able to say that we are just about at the minimum job requirement for everyone's green card in that program.
For the investors from Vietnam, if they would like to have more information on this project, how would they go about getting that?
Well, they would contact locally in Vietnam, Hanoi, Can Tho, Da Nang, USIS Group, USIS. Has these offices, and consultants are ready and waiting and very educated on our project and our formula.
Thank you. Attorney Hurson, have you had any experience with USIS, and what would be the experiences?
Okay, we've been working with USIS for several years, and they have sourced a number of investors that gave us most of the 100 Vietnamese cases that we've had in the past 2 years. They are responsive and they give us what we require to get the cases filed and successfully approved. We also have Vietnamese attorneys and assistants, and our attorneys and assistants visit Vietnam regularly, every 2-3 months, and we're able to meet with people live if needed.
With the anticipated changes in the laws, what would be your advice to investors now?
Okay, changes are uncertain as to dates. However, the changes that will probably take place in the near future are the price will go up, the areas in which the lower price is available will be redefined, and Vietnam may become a backlog country, which means that they have reached their maximum allowed for any individual country under the current law. So the delays will take place there, which will not be as bad as the China law, where it's taking 10 to 12 years, but it could delay cases about a year or so, depending on the date of filing. Also, the advice is file as soon as you can to lock in the current price range and location.
Mr. Hayden, one of the concerns that the investors from everywhere, I suppose, have would be the return of the investment. Is there anything that New York City Research Center can do to reassure them that the investment with your projects is safe?
Yes, I mean, as I mentioned, we have sort of a different construct in terms of how we structure our EB-5 investors in the project, where we're actually a senior direct lender, institutional quality lender. We have 21 project approvals, and we have repaid our first two projects, total of $125 million, 100% to 250 families. This year, we're hopeful that we may repay as many as 400 families. And all of these projects were launched on schedule, certain number of months apart, and we seem to be on schedule at this point in time. We will continue to pay back former investors, as well as introduce new projects like we have now, which are very strong, high-quality projects.
With the anticipated changes in the law, as Attorney Hersons had mentioned, do you expect any changes in the procedures or in your operations?
No, I mean, other than addressing those changes in modifying our documents accordingly, there'll be nothing that we will do differently. We will still be structuring the same informal public-private partnerships with government in New York and offering those types of projects to our investors.
So any advice to the investors if they're considering EB-5 now?
Yeah, I mean, I would follow the same advice that David Herson and Herson Partners gives to everyone. Now is the time to take advantage of sort of the option. It's almost a free option. With the price going up so dramatically, potentially, I would file now. I would file quickly and responsibly with a good regional center that has an approved project, that has approved individual investors in the current project that they're offering. Ours is about 85% complete, so all the risk is gone. So you're avoiding risk, and I would work with David Herson Partners in terms of an experienced law firm to make sure that your source of funds are qualified and expressly, you know, submitted in a responsible way with all the bells and whistles that USCIS requires to get approved.
Attorney Herson, Mr. Hayden just mentioned a very important issue which concerns a lot of investors from Vietnam. That is a source of fund. Any advice on that?
The advice is basically be very detailed as to where the money's come from. So my three questions are, where is the money now? Where did it come from? And how is it getting to the US? And if you can show this as an unbroken chain with documents, you will be successful in that source of funds report. Transfer of funds is out of the scope of our actual work, and therefore transfer of funds, you need to be in compliance because we won't advise anything that should be against the laws of any country.
How about the time requirements in the different stages? Would that be a concern for investors?
Yes, there are three stages, the I-526 to file with immigration. It then goes to Saigon for consular processing. You then sit in a 2-year conditional resident status, and 19 months to 21 months later, you will file the I-829 to remove the conditions. The sooner you get filed, the better. If you have young children who will be turning 21 fairly soon, get the cases in as soon as possible to lock in their ages as well as to lock in the price and the location.
Mr. Hayden, the last question goes to you. With respect to the time requirement, as Attorney Hersons had mentioned, how does that play into the process of returning the investment money to the investors?
Well, it in many cases, it's sequential. So in our current project, we're able to repay the investors once they've gotten their I-829 approval. So given the type of project we have with as much cash equity from the company, Fresh Direct, as well as JP Morgan Bank, that's in the project, which is about 60%. Those institutions and companies will want to return some of their own equity quickly, but they can't until they repay our investors. So there'll be a moment very soon in 2022 where they'll have a prepared financial plan to refinance and repay all of our investors. So that's a very short term, provided that the investors have achieved their I-829.
Thank you, gentlemen. That's a lot of information, a lot of great information. Unfortunately, we ran out of time. So we thank you for your time, and we wish you well and hope to see you again soon.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you for having us.
Xin kính chào quý vị.